this mortal body is not going to restrain me from letting every tornado of wildness through.
It's a new era.
We're fascinated by what's next.
You have to commit your heart and soul and spirit and energy. Everyone's got each other's back, and that comes across.
We're very happy where we are. Everybody's win-win for everybody.
And it's all based in love for this magical thing.
The Red Hot Chili Peppers, you are on the record with Fuse.
Howdy.
Howdy.
Welcome. Pleasure to be here.
Thank you.
You talked about I'm with you as a new beginning.
Did I use those words?
I think so.
Did I?
Yeah.
My goodness, that sounds so self-helpy. It's a new era, and it is a great and exciting thing to have a new personality who's so into music to play with.
Music is so infinite. We're fascinated by what's next, what's beyond, our curiosity, and it's all based in love for this magical thing.
You're talking about the adventures of Rain Dance Maggie. Who is Maggie?
There is a Maggie. There are many Maggies. And, you know, I just wove a little patchwork of that together for the song lyrically.
I mean, I see in your lyrics photographs, so I get images. But then, right, do you try to keep it sort of cryptic so I can't just unlock the whole thing?
Some of it's unlockable. Some of it, you know, is up to the own. It's going to mean something different to you, hopefully, than it means to Chad.
It becomes like poetry in that way, in that, you know, sort of.
You have your experience with it, yeah, which is better. I like it when people have an interpretation that would have never occurred to me. But I do want to just say that the I'm with you part, although it is open to interpretation, generally I would say has a very warm and welcoming connotation.
Of togetherness.
I mean, yeah, the idea of like everyone being with everyone and everyone being connected and we're all the same. And Josh, it was Josh's idea.
I'm with you was your idea?
He brought it to the table.
How did you come to this album cover made by this contemporary art superstar, Damien Hirst?
He's our friend.
Yeah.
The phone, pretty much.
Just call him up.
Yeah.
I need something for my album cover.
Yeah, I mean,
hook me
you
up.
You know, he's a superstar artist, but he's also a very down-to-earth dude. We aimed real high, and he said, cool.
I mean, there's a real iconic image there. Hirst works with flies, he works with pills. But what does it mean as the visual thing to represent I'm with you?
Well, it can mean a lot of different things. You know, the fly could be said to be making love to the pill, and there could be that union of filth and pharmacy.
I think about the current world of people being addicted to mood pills. It's creating a new culture that didn't really exist as much in the world before. For me, any great art that like any artist aspires to do something transcendently great, that great art can be interpreted a million different ways.
Yes.
And each life finds its own meaning within the art form.
Are you sonically different plus Josh than you were before?
Of course. Josh is a huge part of the creative process.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Can you define how the sound is a little different now than it was before, pre-Josh?
I definitely different.
I don't know what went. It used to be I wasn't on stage, and now I am.
You know, Josh is very much his own person. And Josh, you know, from an early age, dedicated himself to being an artist.
Josh was with you through the Stadium Arcadium tour, so you knew what it was like to be with these guys. Describe for me the moment. How do you actually invite somebody to join this fraternity?
I called Josh, and he was at the Dodger game, and asked him.
And what do you say?
Well, he said,
What did you say?
He said, would you like to be the guitar player of the Red Hot Chili Peppers?
And the greatest thing is Josh did not say yes. He's like, I need to think about that.
Well, yeah,
which is really an appropriate response.
Why is that appropriate?
Because this is a life-changing thing where you have to commit your heart and soul and spirit and energy and time and body and to something that you haven't been doing your whole life. You know, it's a big commitment.
And very specifically, I had to think, well, I have to become a guitarist again. Like, I for a long time, hadn't really been focusing on the guitar.
Chad, before Josh joined the group, was there a moment when you thought, maybe it won't go on?
Yeah, we had taken a two-year hiatus. John Frusciante called everyone and said, you know what, I don't want to keep playing. I want to pursue my own thing. And so I did for a while, a few months there, and then Flea called me up and was like, you know what, let's do this.
But you too thought, when John said no more, that maybe that was the end of things.
I remember thinking, like, in my meditative times, that if John left, that I wouldn't want to do it anymore. It would be ridiculous to do it without him. But when he came to me and said, I'm done, I'm not doing it anymore, I felt something else which soon came into my thought, which was, I really love this band. Like, I'm just grateful. We don't need to do it. But it's like, we love it.
You guys are financially blessed. Your legacy is secure.
All those things are cool, you know.
You guys have rocked the whole world. So you say you don't need to do it. So why keep doing it?
Because I like playing music.
Yeah.
And this is where I play music. This is where I get to write songs and be with my musical family.
Can you take me back to high school and the moment you guys met and there was some slight violence involved?
Not really. I had been uprooted from one school district to another. So I went to Fairfax, where nobody knew me. But I didn't have any friends, save for this one very nerdy, diminutive, geeky character. And I was talking to him on the schoolyard, and Flea, who was then known as Mike, came strolling up and started being a little bit abrasive. And I was like, whoa, back off, buddy. This is my one and only friend. And it turns out they were actually friends. And he was just roughhousing.
That's the way I remember it. I had him in a headlock and I was giving him a noogie. You know, a noogie to the head.
I feel like you came up on us and headlocked him.
Right. And you were like, he told me, like, in no uncertain terms, lay off him. And you were, you know, I was scared of him. He had a crew cut, like the crazy crew cut that nobody had in our 10th grade. And I just was like, okay, just joking around, we're friends here. It was like the first day of school. And we had this alcoholic teacher who drank booze behind his desk. So at least that's what
drank booze out of the milk carton.
Yeah, yeah.
And God bless him.
And he came out the first day and he said, if any student, if you're caught writing on your desk, you know, you're expelled, failed, done with. But then Anthony got up to go to the, raise his hand, I have to go to the bathroom. As soon as he got up, went to the bathroom, I wrote on his desk, Anthony Kiedis was here. Went back. And he came back and found that and started writing, you know, on my desk. That was when we really bonded.
And where did Hillel enter into this too? Because he was there in high school with you as well, right?
I didn't really meet Hillel till about a year later. And I realized that he was very different, had a very artistic soul and just a different way of looking at life. And he played music, he got out the records and, you know, played some music. And I was like, oh, this guy's pretty cool.
And he goes on to become a really important part of the band and your musical development.
Right? Yeah, well, we became kind of an inseparable threesome. Hillel was already pretty dedicated to guitar and more or less introduced Flea to bass guitar.
Yeah, I never thought about it till Hillel said, why don't you start playing the bass and join our rock band?
You guys are rocking, you're making great music, people are paying attention to the band, and he dies. And how did you feel?
Oh God, well, devastated beyond, almost impossible to actually fully digest a loss of that size. I don't think any of us ever really thought that that would happen, even though they're, you know, we were pretty messed up at that point.
But you couldn't go to the funeral?
I went to Mexico instead to try to separate myself from life and the world and drugs and everything.
The thing that was hardest for me was the feeling of it being unresolved. Like, you know, at that age and you feel like you're just about to figure something out. Like, how do I relate to life and what's my mission? How do I get through this, like, strangling feeling that I've got in life? And I felt like Hillel was just starting to try to figure something out and was stopped. But in retrospect now, I just, you know, feel like his spirit really lives on within us, yeah, within our band, as well as I feel at peace with, you know, it was time for him to go, and I feel, you know, his spirit is there.
Did you go to the grave and talk to him and make your peace with him after you came back from Mexico?
I did, yeah. I didn't go to the grave with the intention of necessarily resolving that closure, but just, you know, I have to take some kind of action. So I went there and sat down and had a little talk at the gravestone, and definitely found something bigger than I was looking for, and made that connection, you know, whatever that connection is, and was able to say goodbye. And I don't think there was ever any doubt in Hillel's mind or spirit how much we loved him.
Talk about writing with you, which is really like jamming, right? And looking for something, right? And letting something come out of the playing and the improvising, and then the lyrics come, right?
That's a big part of it. We do jam relentlessly, and then we search through those jams for the magical moments that we want to elaborate on. And, you know, sometimes you hear just a little rub inside the music and you feel like, wait a second, that could come to life as a song. But Flea was very instrumental in coming in with things that he had created on piano for this record, which is kind of a new thing for us. And Josh, you know, has a lifetime of musical passion that he walked into the room with, and all kinds of different little ideas. Anything goes, you know, any idea can be turned into a song, a jam.
I mean, I could tell anything goes because you guys don't confine yourselves at all. Here's some funk, here's some punk, here's some rock, here's some hip-hop influence. It's just, you know, free jazz is coming in.
I'm glad you hear the free jazz.
Yeah. We're just, you know, we're so lucky for this era of our band. And Josh has bought it and given us new life and given us a whole new dimension. It's not just fitting in, he's helping us turn into something that we've never been.
You talk about the different eras in your band, and your sound is really critical to the band. And you really were slap bass earlier on, and now you play much more melodically. I just wonder, how did that development come about?
It's like I said before, music is this infinite thing, and I'm always trying to be open to what's in the air and to let it flow through me and to keep myself as focused and as diligent about nurturing myself as a musician so that I'm capable to ride the waves of music when they come.
And you've developed a lot over the years. You were very rapper-ish at the beginning, and now you're a very melodic, expressive singer. Talk about how you've grown as a vocalist.
Well, obviously, we've been doing it long enough. I wouldn't want to have stagnated with one limiting style. The band has changed a lot, and I had to change with the band. My tastes have changed. My ability to express myself has changed.
When they present you, or when you find a groove that they've done, and now you're going to add your part to it, how do you know this one I'm going to sing, this one I'm going to rap?
I just listen. Whatever feels really right, whatever feels good in my heart. Hard to describe.
Have you changed over the years?
Me, I'm much taller now. I used to be a short lad. I'm 6'3", still grown. I'm like baby Huey over here.
You fitting in that chair?
I'm actually sitting on the ground. Musically, I'm just trying to get better, you know, and grow and change and challenge myself. And I'm so lucky to play with musicians that are like-minded.
One of the things that really just makes you guys who you are is what you do on stage. Talk about what you want to do, what you want to accomplish when you get on stage, and how you prepare to get on stage and give that to the people.
I'm not really conscious of what to do or what I want to do or anything. You know, I try and prepare, make sure my fingers are, you know, limber. But I just, you know, I just try to be myself, and I can't help but just go, you know, nuts and have a good time. And
I mean, I think about you up there, no shirt on, flinging your hair around, you flinging your head around, you're going nuts and banging me in the chest, and there's very few people, maybe nobody, who gives the energy that you guys give.
We let the music move us and try to free ourselves completely, where it's not like us making this effort to move around. It's like it's us making an effort to surrender and let the music ragdoll us like a wave will ragdoll you. And I feel like in a lot of way, like with contemporary bands, it's becoming sort of a lost art. remember seeing the Circle Jerks and like walking in, and it was like, ugh, this feeling, they're gonna explode out of their skin. It's like, this mortal body is not gonna restrain me from letting every tornado of wildness through.
You guys are all parents, and I wonder how that changes you as musicians.
Wow, I'm late to the club. Josh has yet to join the club. These guys have been at it for a good long time.
So you've been at it for plenty long.
Okay.
Plenty long. You're fully in the club.
Oh, I'm in the club. I love the club.
Yeah.
It's wild.
Yeah.
It helps everything.
I love being a father and wanted to be a father long before I had any business being a father. That kind of love I had never experienced before. You know, that kind of like unconditional, do anything for a person love.
Did it change you?
It opened my eyes to like just a pure joy. You know, to watch your 2-year-old bounce up and down to a drum beat, the simplest drum beat, is nothing. I'll play that for a half an hour.
Yeah.
You know, instead, if he wasn't there, I probably wouldn't play it for 5 minutes.
You guys have also been sober for a while now, right?
Well, that's kind of a sweeping statement, but yeah. I mean, we all have our own relationship to that, I think.
Well, it's a musical question. Where I was going was the impact on your music that sobriety has.
Well, again, I think that's an individual experience. I mean, I would not be the person I am had I not gone through the weirdness and the experience of earlier years. But you know, for me, it was very sort of clear and beautifully obvious that sobriety allowed me to focus on things that I love, like friendships and family and music and nature and life. So it works for me.
Yeah. The song that changes your career is Under the Bridge. Talk about that song and like just it being this rocket fuel of taking you to a whole nother top level.
You know, we had sort of come through some difficult times and we were making our second record with John. We had hired Rick and we were...
Rick Rubin.
You know, Rick found some lyrics that he liked in one of my notebooks and inquired, and I sang him some raggedy-ass version of Under the Bridge, out of tune and in 3 different keys, and he's like, oh, I really like that, let's do that. It was a little bit of a leap for us because we had never really written an official ballad, but it wasn't something that we shied away from.
You guys have accomplished so much, you've done so much, and I'm sure the bucket lists are triple checked and all that. So how much longer does this thing go on?
I don't think we're worried about how long it's gonna go. My bucket list includes playing a show tomorrow night with Josh and Chad and Flea.
I just like, for me now, every second that we're doing anything to do with this band, I'm so happy to be doing it and to be a part of it and to feel the connection that we have between us, you know, each one of us equally giving their hearts and creating this thing that I treasure every moment of.
Thanks, guys. It's been awesome.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thanks, man.
Well done. Thank you.